How is it going? Welcome back to my channel. And yes, today I'm really excited. Why? Because I have an author whose genre is something I really love and like. It is crime fiction. I have Mr. Vish Dhamija with me. His novels Bhindi Bazaar, Lipstick, Unlawful Justice and many more are very famous. I don't need to introduce those novels to you. But we'll be talking to him on the genre of crime fiction, especially his character Rita Ferreira, what inspires him to write that genre, crime fiction, which I love. So let us talk to him and understand the genre and his work. Come.
So my question is that Rita Ferreira in her series Bhindi Bazaar is trying to solve a crime and she sees a pattern. In Lipstick there is a pattern of victims' lips being painted dark red. Mm-hmm. So do you really feel criminals follow a pattern knowingly or unknowingly?
So like I started that criminals are a big word or one word that encompasses all kind of criminals. Whereas it is not so. Every criminal is a different kind. So both in Bhindi Bazaar and Lipstick, I have touched upon what we call a serial killer. Okay. Now, serial killer, whether you read the true crimes based in US, UK, even in India, or fiction where it's based in based anywhere in the world, serial killers definitely have a pattern. And I'll explain it to you why. The reason somebody is killing randomly is because largely, and now whatever I say is 90-95% of the group there that you kind of talk about, there'll always be 5% who'll fall outside the bracket. These people have a pent-up anger, a pent-up frustration, or some old episode in life that is bothering them over and over again. So what a serial killer normally does is he kills the subject again and again. So a lot of serial killers, for example, have a problem with someone, if it's a male serial killer, it would have a problem with someone female, I'm just building up a case as I'm going along, in his childhood, somebody dominating him, could be his mother, could be his auntie, could be his neighbor, and therefore his frustration begins in killing either them first. Sometimes the serial killer doesn't kill the person who's actually affected him, but finds replicas, for lack of a better word, similar looking people. Now, similar looking people or similar people or people behaving in a similar pattern. So if you notice, if you read a lot of, I wouldn't call it literature, but yeah, loosely literature, you'll see that you would have a pattern of a similar kind of women or a similar kind of men. So they would either be physically looking similar to each other, or they would behave similarly. So they would go after street girls, call girls, because they have this problem with the call girl system. So that's why when it comes to a serial killer, because serial killer, there is no other way of catching him or her. The reason is, it's so random. Normally when there's a murder, there's a motive. So you either had an animosity towards me, or it was a drunken brawl, or you came to steal, rob me and something went wrong, or there was an old padla kind of revenge kind of thing. However, so basically you could lead, okay, if I'm murdered, who all know me, and who could gain the maximum, or who had a vendetta against me, or who had something to gain. But if I'm killed and no one I know has a motive to kill me, it then falls to someone who had no motive. Less killing is the most difficult to find out, because you cannot lead one thing to the other. And then when you find a second corpse and there is similarity between the two, like they've been either killed in the same way or killed for the same purpose, like in Lipstick, I don't know if you've read, is because he didn't like women who played outside their marriages. In Bhindi Bazaar, he was targeting Johns who were getting call girls into his room. So that's the only way to catch a serial killer. Unless, of course, you catch him in the act, which is difficult again, because serial killers, all those have been caught, are above average IQ. They plan, they carry out their task, for lack of a better word, not murder, or murder in a meticulous way, not leaving clues. There are so many of them that have never been caught. Zodiac killer, for example. Jack the Ripper was never caught. Ted Bundy was not caught in killing, or because he was kind of, I think he was driving without a license or parked wrongly. So it's very difficult to catch them unless you know how they are behaving, who they will target next, and how do you go after them.
Okay.
But a normal criminal doesn't leave a pattern. It would, a normal criminal largely would either leave clues or the motive would lead you to the criminal.
Okay.
When I say him, it's because in police books, unless otherwise proved, the criminal is always considered masculine, a male.
Okay.
So the police would always talk about him and he, unless something proved the other way around. In most police around the world. So when I say him, I don't mean him. It's that's the way it is. Does that answer your question?
Yeah, it does answer. Life of an investigating officer in a police department is very tough. So how are you able to relate to that life?
Because I'm tough. No. Okay, so I have a lot of family in the police.
Achcha.
So my so a lot of so I have seen them. So just for instance, one of them was here when the big scandal in Gurgaon happened recently. About a year and a half back, some child was murdered in the school. And I could see that he had to rush, get the flight, whatever comes, he has to get there in Gurgaon. So you understand that there are certain responsibilities of that job and it has to be taken seriously. And I've seen them work. He and his wife both are in the police.
Okay.
And I have other friends who are in the police. So it's a difficult subject because you have to not only understand what the investigator is going through, you also need to understand the police procedures. Now, whether the police in real life in India flaunts, and jumps over the rules, when you're writing fiction, you want it as close to the book as possible. And if you break a law as an investigator, you have to show that he or she is breaking the law. So whenever Rita Ferreira steps outside the boundary line, she makes sure that she tells the audience that I am stepping outside the boundary line. I do not have a court order for this. So I shouldn't be doing this. But let's keep it under the wraps and get to him and then come back. So yes, it's a difficult life. So, but police procedurals are part of thriller writing since I think Sherlock Holmes was not police. Who else? Police procedurals are part of crime fiction, I would imagine. It is difficult, but yeah, as long as you understand the boundaries and then break them, that's fine.
Why did you choose a female protagonist as Rita Ferreira, not a male protagonist? Any particular reason?
No, I don't think I had a reason for choosing a female over a male. I was looking for a character because when I wrote Bhendi Bazaar, it was the book before that I had written was published in 2010. So that we talk about later. And this was something of a story that came to me that this could be done. And I was looking for a protagonist who could, because the villain otherwise could steal the limelight in Bhendi Bazaar of the entire backstory and stuff. I wanted someone who could stand ground and come across as not as a superhero, not your underwear over the trousers Superman, but someone who was brave, bright, but also realistic, so people could relate to, so people can relate to Rita Ferreira, that she has. The idea was to have a male or a female. The idea was to have a personality that kind of the reader could align with and reader could relate to. And in the end, it was Rita Ferreira. And I'm so glad. And I did, if you read the first edition of Bhendi Bazaar, I had written that if you guys like Rita Ferreira, you could let me know so I could develop a series. And I had endless mails from readers saying they really like the character of Rita Ferreira. Why? That he saw Rita Ferreira by airport. And I said, no, she's fictional. You can't. Which means she had kind of transcended from paper to reality. And therefore, the other one, and I've written another one which has gone to the editor.
Okay.
It was never a question of male or female. It was the personality should come through. And I think Rita came through pretty well.
Okay. And when you write about a chase where they are chasing criminals, what is that one thing you keep in mind for that major twist in the story?
See, I'm not a very method writer. So there are various, so some people plan every chapter and they know how the twist would happen, XYZ, and I really appreciate that. There are others who are absolutely free flow. So they start, and I've heard some of my friends when we meet at lit fests and stuff talking about it, that even in the penultimate chapter, the author didn't know who would be the killer. So he then decided who it should be. For me, I have the beginning in mind. So what is the crime? Now, whether it's going to be robbery or murder or rape or whatever the crime is. And I know how the police would get to him or her. So I have the two, the beginning and the end in mind. So how, what is the crime? Who does it? Who will catch him and how? So these are the four pillars of my story writing. Now, as you start writing, and it is from Bedi Bazaar time that I realized that you constantly think of subplots.
Okay.
So the subplots are interesting sidelines. However, they should be interesting enough to stand on their own, but not take away from the main plot, because you don't want to drive the reader so far down the line that she or he loses track of what the actual story is. So those side stories could be a red herring, because they are there for this. Some of them can lead to what the end result is, and some of them are just there because they are nice and then they are red herrings and people think something is going to happen. But and no, so I do not have a final twist in mind, but the final way they'll get caught is something I keep it till the end. Now, what every, if you read every crime fiction, and this is what I'm, when you read it backwards, so after you finished, you realize that there were four clues that you missed. But those clues, at the time when you're reading, don't sound like clues.
Okay.
So, those are the, I mean, those are the four clues that you leave, that the reader in the end feels, I missed it. It's never that it came out of the blue. It's always somebody misses it. So that's it. And sometimes it's not about a twist. Like in Bhendi Bazaar, I was told by a lot of people that they knew who it possibly could be. But the fact that you read till the end means the story had enough gravitas to stand on its own. You don't have to have a whodunit every time. Because even if you knew who it could be, you didn't know who it was. And even if you knew who it was, it was how and why. And so it's a lot more than just how done it, which people, after reading a lot of Poirot, think that he'll bring everyone to the room, everyone will sit, and then he'll say, you are the criminal. It doesn't work like that. I think that was an older pattern, and some people, I still love Agatha Christie, but I can't write that. Neither do I aspire to.
You know the end of your story, like a very fixed end, for example, that this guy is the murderer, and he's... So, and you know the beginning of the story, and then you drive your plot through that pattern of it. Yes, the end is fixed in your stories.
Yeah, 90%. There's always a chance that as you ride through it, in one of the novels, I changed it halfway through. Because the person, because it was so big, nobody knew who it was, there was a chance that you could kill this guy and then make the other guy the murderer. But largely, I stick to that beginning and the end of who it is.
Question, this Agatha Christie, when you read, she had a very closed pattern, very closed places, for example, a plane or a house where, you know, the family members or perhaps the servant or somebody, it was a very closed thing. But now the current scenario is that you write a thriller and it's the some criminal who you cannot see in the whole story comes out as a murderer. So, sir, what is the, what, in your opinion, which is more engaging, the ones which were closed or the ones which are very open and some third person which the reader cannot guess comes out as the murderer?
So mainly in Agatha Christie it was the third person who came from out blue. But there's no set pattern. You can't have a fixed formula, because you times have changed. So even the films, if you see the black and white era to today's, then a lot of technology is coming. So what an author of today has to deal with, then you can't say that he didn't have a phone. Just for example, so you have phone, you have Skype, you have technology, you can trace someone with the mobile phone if you've read The Heist Artist. It's very simple technology. In those days, it was gun, poison, and then there you go. There was otherwise, there was a tide that you could sink someone in. But there are more the ways of killing, more and people, and also because there were limited number of authors at the time who were published. There were limited number of books. Now you have a plethora of writers and books and publications and people are exposed to more stuff. So television, your digital assets. So with technology, with the moving times, everything has changed in the last 100 years. So how do you expect a story writer to stick to a formula? Plus, there's no winning or losing formula. You've had some of the best directors in films who give a flop. If I knew what would be a hit, then why would I have a flop?
My last question is, how different is who has done it from how it has been done, and what is more challenging to write? Who has done it or how it has been done?
I guess they're both challenging in their own way. So who done it is very simple, because it's not simple. So you know, so in how done it, it is possible for the author to let the reader know that who's done it. But the whole thrill is about that the protagonist doesn't know. And every turn, the reader is kind of hyperventilating as to what will happen now, because this guy, the protagonist that the reader is reading, is going into a room where the reader knows the criminal is with a knife. So it's like a normal horror film kind of, or a thriller kind of thing. So most of the films that you see are not whodunit. It's the hero doesn't know, and therefore the hero has danger of getting killed, and that is what the thrilling part of. So there's this whole three. I forget the exact definitions, but I'm sure you can Google. There's a suspense, there's a mystery, and there's a thriller. And people quite often confuse the three amongst each other. I think the suspense is, thriller is where the reader knows what is happening. If the protagonist doesn't know. Suspense and mystery, if you look up, you'll find the exact definition. So there are three.
Okay.
How done it, especially if it's a legal thriller, you could show someone killing, but how will the prosecutor or the defense lawyer get him off, takes him into another realm of things.
Okay. So thank you so much.
So guys, we were in conversation with Mr. Vish Dhamija. I just love the genre, and it has really, really taught me how crime fiction is written. But for more lessons, he'll give you tips for aspiring authors. Do tune in tomorrow at 7:30 p.m. Perhaps it may answer a few questions for which you might be struggling. So yes, do tune in 7:30 tomorrow. Till then, bye. Take care.